Okay, that's broadcasting back on, and the final item of business today is a members' business debate on motion 7711 in the name of Christine Graham on St Andrew's Children's Society. The debate will be concluded without any votes being questions being asked. I would ask members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite Christine Graham to open the debate for around about 7 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I understand this is the highlight of today. Deputy Presiding Officer, can I first congratulate members of the Society who would have been here had decision time been at 5 p.m. Fortunately, I was able to alert them there's a delay. And thank those who signed my motion to allow the debate and those who have stayed behind in the face, as I say, of competing attractions on this auspicious day. The motion marks the centenary of the Society, understood to be the oldest adoption and fostering agency in Scotland, and its history and procedures today reflect the changing societal attitudes to single mothers, which were addressed so poignantly in the Chamber last week when the then First Minister offered an apology to those who were forced to give up their babies born then out of what we call wedlock. I'm old enough to recall the attitudes of those days, and I'll expand on this shortly. Recently, I sponsored an event here to commemorate the centenary of the Society and was very moved by the accounts of two recent adopters. But first, I must mention Maureen McAvoy, a founding member of the Society, who's written a commemorative booklet on the history of the Society, an extraordinary woman, foster carer and adopter herself. I will quote from her first experience, quote, "It's 55 years since my husband and I approached the Catholic Social Services Centre with the hope of adopting a child. I'd like to share a reflection on our first adoption experience. On Monday, 1st July 1968, life changed forever for my husband Jim and me, because that was the day that we brought home our first adopted daughter. We'd always hoped to have children, but after years of unsuccessful tests, we decided in 1967 that adoption would be the route to our family. On Tuesday, 28th June 1968, Jim's birthday, we received a letter telling us about Jenny, who was 3 months old. We went to see her at her foster family on Wednesday and then began a hectic whirl of activity. I handed in my notice, and my employers, who knew of our adoption plans, allowed me to leave work on the Friday. Work was hectic as I finished off as much as I could and handed over the rest of my work to sympathetic colleagues. We had to collect the pram we had ordered and buy lots of baby paraphernalia, including lots of terry toweling nappies. I remember those. We had been waiting 9 months for news of a baby and had been too worried that it was never going to happen, so had bought very little. There was no paternal leave in those days, and after we got home, buying formula milk on the way, Jim just had time for a cup of tea before going back to the office. No sooner had he gone than Jenny started crying, and I had to set about her first feed. Boiling the water, mixing the feed, then cooling the bottle seemed to take forever, and her wails got louder and louder. I felt a total failure in that first hour. Both of our families welcomed Jenny into the wider family, and although we had never heard of funneling in those days, we were very gradual in introducing her to our many family members. Jim's sister and husband lived in Edinburgh with their 5 children, and Jenny loved spending time with her cousins. When I learn now of the phased introductions for adopted children and hear of continued contact with foster parents, I realise that Jenny's move to our home was harder for her than it needed to be, and only her sunny nature seemed to make it so easy. No life story book for her. All we got was about 10 lines of information and no photos of her before she came to us. In 1968, babies were placed with families, some straight from hospital, but the birth mother was unable to give full consent for a child to be adopted until 3 months after giving birth, and she was able to reclaim her child at any time during that period. After 3 months, adopters could launch a petition to adopt the child, and if the mother changed her mind before the adoption order was granted, there had to be a legal hearing to decide the best interests of the child. Changed times, thankfully, for birth parents, foster parents and adopters, and most importantly, the children. I close quotes. When the agency was established in Edinburgh in 1922, it helped unmarried mums find homes for their babies, as were the social norms at that time. Now it helps find homes for vulnerable children and welcomes adoption and fostering inquiries from all members of the community, including single people, people who follow faith, those who don't, and members of the LGBTQI+, through its offices in Edinburgh and Aberdeen. In 2010, it entered into partnership with After Adoption in England and Wales to be their exclusive providers in Scotland for their groundbreaking parenting programme, SafeBase. It was supported by the Scottish Government to get this initiative off the ground, and it has presented courses in many locations throughout Scotland. It also offers courses on TheraPlay to all its adopters to help them reduce the development gaps that many adopted children have experienced in their early life, because children adopted today may very well suffer from the physical effects of parental alcohol or drug addiction. The centenary event in itself was a delight and heartwarming, and it exemplified how far adoption has come. Two parents with their children present told us their stories. One, a single gay male with his adopted teenage son, another gay male couple who'd adopted three siblings, two little girls and a boy. All the children were in their best behaviour and beautifully turned out. The wee girls were in tartan skirts with Arden sweaters and their brother in marching trews. Dad told us how he and his partner had intended to adopt just one child, but when they were introduced to the wee trio, there was only one decision for them. From no family to having three children was quite a life-changing experience. No more exotic holidays or posh restaurants for them, more like burger bars and play areas. As Dad said, he wouldn't change it for the world. Throughout his speech, you could hear his wee family seated with his partner, encouraging him with cries of, "Daddy, Daddy." He wasn't dry-eyed, and neither was I, and neither was the minister who is now sitting in front of me. In conclusion, it is appropriate this debate follows on from the statement of the First Minister last week, apologising on behalf of us all for the way the state treated unwed mothers in past decades, which St Andrew's Children's Society fully recognises, to where we and the society are now, and I wish them and all their foster and adoptive parents and their children well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. I now call Ros McCall to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Around 4 minutes, Ms McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Christine Graham for bringing this debate to chamber. I always welcome the chance to further the awareness of all forms of care experienced children, and it's a pleasure to speak in the debate today. The importance of understanding the issues affecting care experienced people is the key to changing many lives for the better, and sadly we have not done enough in Scotland yet to make that happen. I would like to add my congratulations to St Andrew's Children's Society on its centenary, making it the oldest adoption and fostering agency in existence in Scotland, which has already been mentioned. And over that 100 years, adoption and fostering has changed so much. Practices such as forced adoption are thankfully a thing of the past. And briefly on that, I would like to mention that as much as the apology last week was a great start, there is still so much more that needs to be done to fix the ongoing problems facing forced adopters and adult adoptees, and I look forward to working with the new Scottish Government on that. I also want to applaud St Andrew's Children's Society for their understanding. Any society working in this field for over 100 years will have seen massive changes to wider societal view, especially on adoption and fostering, and I am delighted to see that the Society provides support for women to help them cope with lifelong emotional impact of having a child adopted. I would also like to praise St Andrew's Children's Society for their use of the Safe Base programme, often known as the Secure Base model. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm sure you're aware that TheraPlay principles of Safe Base helps adopted parents understand the impact of the child's past experiences of trauma and of loss. When my husband and I adopted our daughters, we were given the following analogy, just for how the brain develops in a child, and that experienced and has experienced attachment issues in early years trauma. Imagine a mind is being built up like a wall. Every brick is a literal building block to brain development. So, for example, if a baby is not held, emotional and visual responses are not met, and then that building block is not formed, creating a gap in the wall. Now move on in life, building another layer of brick on the wall. Every brick built on top of a gap is built on top of nothing, a literal unstable foundation. Our daughters came to live with us when they were 5 and 2. Very young ages, but even at this age, the gaps in their development were very obvious. My eldest daughter, at the age of 5, had such emotional gaps that for over a year, I cradled her in my arms as you would a baby to try and build that emotional and visual connection in a hope to plug that gap in her development. Deputy Presiding Officer, every time there is a lack of positive parenting or trauma, there is a gap in the wall. And understanding this is the essential to supporting adopted and fostered children through the milestones of their life. Using programmes like SafeBase, St Andrew's Children's Society are giving children adopted through their agency and their parents the real chance of fixing the wall without it coming tumbling down. So in closing, I would like to thank St Andrew's Children's Society for all the work they do. I heard from some inspiring families when they came to the parliamentary event that's already been mentioned, and the positive and grateful testimonies are credit, if it was needed, to the support and assistance society gives to care experienced children and their families. And to them, I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr McCall. I now call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Around 4 minutes, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate my colleague Christine Graham on securing this important debate to mark the centenary of St Andrew's Children's Society, celebrated in 2022. Whilst providing adoption and foster care services since 1922 by ensuring families are prepared to meet the needs of vulnerable children, the agency has also supported thousands of birth mothers coping with the loss of a child through adoption. Their staff have striven to show compassion to all that have passed through their doors and continue to do so present, highlighting the essential wider work that the agency carries out. And I speak as someone whose grandmother was adopted in very difficult circumstances, albeit in 1905, long before the St Andrew's Society came into existence. With 13,500 children being looked after in Scotland, it's imperative to celebrate when agencies are getting it right. It's also vital to reflect and learn from the stories of care-experienced children and adults to improve the services and support on offer for both the children and their parents. St Andrew's Children's Society are a brilliant example of an agency getting it right, particularly with their implementation of the SafeBase parenting programme. As the only Scottish agency offering this service, the therapeutic programme for parents of adopted and fostered children who have attachment issues is essential to ensure that key psychological building blocks typically developed in the first 18 months of life are stimulated using play. It's encouraging to see the effectiveness of this programme, ultimately improving the relationship between foster parents and their children and reducing any behavioural issues. I encourage the Minister to explore the benefits of the SafeBase parenting programme further and the possibility of supporting its extension to agencies across Scotland to ensure the needs of care-experienced children are met, whilst also reducing adoption breakdown. Foster carers play an intrinsic role in allowing the important work of St Andrew's Children's Society to take place. In Scotland, there are approximately 3,415 approved foster care homes, but a shortage of almost 500 foster carers. And it's encouraging that the Scottish Government is working with key national and local partners, including the third sector, to identify action to increase the number of Scots willing to foster. Whilst providing £145,000 in funding to the fostering network annually to raise the profile of foster caring and encourage the recruitment of new carers. Becoming a foster carer is a significant commitment, and it's essential that local authorities have the funding to provide a fair weekly fostering allowance to cover the cost of caring for a child. However, with only one local authority in Scotland, Argyll and Bute, paying above England and Wales national minimum allowance across all 5 age ranges, I urge the Minister to consider the implementation of a Scottish minimum allowance to encourage potential foster parents to apply, knowing they will have the financial support to care for a child. A minimum allowance ensures that payments increase in line with inflation, particularly important during this cost of living crisis, as the cost of food, toiletries, clothes and travel are all increasing. It's clear the Scottish Government is dedicated to ensuring that our care system is developed with care experienced people at its heart. The Independent Care Review's research into Scotland's care system listened to over 5,500 lived experiences to identify where improvements are required. The promise is built on five key foundations: voice, family, care, people, and scaffolding and voice. It recognises that children must be listened to. Children must stay in homes where they feel safe and loved. Children should always live with their siblings where safe to do so. Carers must be supported to develop relationships, and both children and their families should be supported by a system that is there when it is needed. As per the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, all children should grow up feeling safe and loved. However, it's important to recognise that care-experienced children require these extra protections even more so. Presiding Officer, I again congratulate St Andrew's Children's Society for marking its centenary, 100 years of dedicated work to better the lives of care-experienced children, foster and adoptive families, helping birth mothers and their families wronged by the adoption system. The work of agencies across Scotland are essential, and I look forward to seeing improvements being implemented by Scottish ministers to help ensure that all our vulnerable children receive the love and safety that they require. And I again thank Christine Graham for bringing this debate to the Chamber.
Thank you very much, Mr Gibson. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Mr Whitfield, around 4 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure, as it nearly always is, to follow Kenneth Gibson's contribution, because I think his notes and comments about fostering and about the struggles that both local authorities but also individuals have in finding foster parents is one that we need to do much greater work at. And in passing, I would mention the challenge that perhaps exists between payments from different local authorities close to each other of differing amounts, and also the different approaches that are taken depending on the challenge of the young person that's seeking to be fostered, and perhaps that could be looked at. But today is a fascinating day, and I think it's a privilege to take part in this debate that Christine Graham has successfully brought to this chamber about an organisation that was last year 100 years old and indeed has sat over so many changes in Scotland, looking on as the entity they were. And it is perhaps fitting that it is today that this is brought, given the circumstances of the political changes that are happening in this country. As has been pointed out, it was founded in 1922, and I think it's important to say it was founded by a group of women. I think that speaks volumes again about the attitude towards young people and the attitude when women in particular see young people in distress, particularly vulnerable children. And the commitment from this organisation over the 100 years has grown and evolved, but has always been on the basis of helping the most vulnerable children and families, and that has remained unwavering. In 1952, it changed its name to become the Advisory Committee for Social Services, and in 1963, divided into two separate organisations, the Catholic Inquiry Service, that dealt with general social services, and the Catholic Social Service Centre, that dealt solely with adoption and foster care. And that does speak, and I think it's very important to mention, it does speak to the founding of this organisation within the Catholic Church, and the fact that as times have changed and the attitude from those within the service progressed, they felt they had to step away from the Catholic Church, but to do so to continue to serve the most vulnerable young people. And I think it shows great prescience about the people who worked in the society at that time that they were happy to make that change. During the 50s and 60s, many thousands of children were placed for adoption. And again, it's been mentioned significantly because of the perception of the time that a single mother could not provide the care that perhaps a married couple could bring. And also in respect of the age of the children that we were discussing, because at that time it was predominantly babies and children under one that were being placed. More than welcome to.
Christine Graham.
It was worse than saying that an unwed mother couldn't take care of them. They were looked upon as being disgraceful. So it was even harder for them because they were going to be bad women.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that intervention. And it is right that the social stigma was not just towards the young children, but also to those young and single mothers. And I think it's interesting when you look at the records of St Andrew's Children's Society, they are in fact able to show a number of single, predominantly women, who decided to keep their baby in the face of that community adverse approach, and were indeed supported by the Children's Society to make that a success. And I think it speaks volumes for a very small number, I accept, but a significantly strong group of women who were able to stand up significantly against their community, but also frequently against their families, to do what they think was best, which was bringing up their child. As the society progressed, obviously the age of children that were being sought to be adopted and fostered changed and became one that I think we recognise more today, which is older children, particularly those which perhaps have significant needs and require support as they move through fostering, but also into adoption. And I think, again, it speaks volumes for the St Andrews Children's Society that they're able to support families into doing this. I realise time is tight and people perhaps have other things, but I would like to mention one event which I think speaks to the strength of this organisation, and that occurred in 2015 when Scotland's National Adoption Register, shall we say, found themselves in trouble at very short notice and effectively had to step away from commitments they had given. And then, without hesitance of a doubt, the St Andrews Children's Society stepped in and agreed to run that register for a period of 2 years up until 2017, when other provisions could be made. So, in closing, can I congratulate the St Andrews Children's Society on its 100th anniversary? For a century, this organisation has been a shining example of what can be achieved when people come together to support those in need. And I look forward to a future where I hope, as has been echoed today, we can redouble our efforts to genuinely build a better world for our children and families across Scotland. I'm grateful, DPM.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. I now call Claire Hawley to respond to the debate minister. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I would like to add my thanks to Christine Graham for initiating today's debate and thank members from across the chamber for their contributions this afternoon. The debate has enabled us as a parliament to congratulate St Andrews Children's Society on marking its centenary last year, and I welcome the opportunity to celebrate this significant milestone and to acknowledge all of those who have played a part in the Society's important work. As was referenced by other speakers in the debate, there was a parliamentary reception earlier this year, and it gave me the chance to offer my congratulations in person and to hear firsthand the experiences of many of those who are involved with the Society. The reception was, Presiding Officer, a profoundly moving event with a number of people sharing personal testimonies about their adoption journeys. We heard from an adoptee who is now a young adult and has become an adoption panel member. We heard from the first single gay man to adopt a child in Scotland. And we heard from a couple who had adopted a sibling group, as Christine Graham mentioned in her speech. And these testimonies and the stories that they shared really illustrate the fantastic support that the Society has provided for so many years. However, as Christine Graham highlighted in the motion for today's debate, this celebration of Scotland's oldest adoption and fostering agency doesn't just enable us to pay credit to the staff and volunteers who have supported the Society over the last 100 years. Importantly, it also enables us to pay credit to adoptive parents and foster carers. And I'd like to put on record my sincere thanks to all caregivers, including adoptive families and foster carers and practitioners working in these sectors. We absolutely recognise the vital part you play in providing nurturing homes and support and love for children and young people across Scotland, and we value the positive difference it can make to their lives. Today's debate also enables us to reflect on our work to keep the promise by 2030, and it's vital that the Scottish Government leads from the front to ensure that all care-experienced children and young people are supported to grow up loved, safe and respected. And we set out a commitment to do that in the Promise Implementation Plan, which was published last year. In the plan, we outlined our vision for delivering a good childhood, to ensure that every child lives in a safe and loving home, and where families are given the support to overcome difficulties and stay together. Our work to keep the promise includes the Whole Family Wellbeing Programme of activity, with an investment of £500 million over the course of this Parliament. And this will transform services to ensure families, including adoptive and foster families, can access the support they need, when and where they need it. And we've allocated £50 million in this year's budget, including £32 million provided directly to Children's Service Planning Partnerships to enable work at a local level. We've also provided over £350,000 in 2022-23 to third sector organisations who provide support at a national level for those affected by adoption, including children, young people, families and adult adoptees. And this includes funding for Adoption Week, a national helpline and support for adoptive families to help minimise adoption breakdowns, the TESA programme, which provides therapeutic input for adoptive families, services for professionals and practitioners in the adoption sector, and the Adoption Contact Register for Scotland, which is hosted by Birthlink, to facilitate contact between adoptees, birth parents and birth relatives. We also fund Scotland's Adoption Register to support finding a family as easily as possible for children identified as needing adoptive placements. As the former First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, mentioned in the national apology she made last week, we're also funding a scoping study looking at what support is required for those that have been affected by historical adoption practices, including adult adoptees. But I do know that St Andrew's Children's Society extends beyond adoption, and so I'll briefly mention foster care too. We are absolutely committed to helping foster carers and provide a range of specific support, and this includes over £150,000 to the Fostering Network Scotland this year. This funding supports Foster Line Scotland service training for foster carers, raising the profile of foster caring and encouraging the recruitment of new carers. And I want to reassure Parliament that, that a priority for me is delivering a Scottish recommended allowance for foster and kinship carers as soon as possible. It has taken far longer than we originally anticipated, and I recognise the frustrations of caregivers and stakeholders. I remain committed to working constructively with COSLA to deliver this as quickly as possible, and we are exploring all available options to do this. More broadly, the foundation of all our work is getting it right for every child, or GIRFEC as it's known. And this is the Scottish Government's commitment to ensuring that all children and young people and their families are offered the right support at the right time, so that every child and young person in Scotland can reach their full potential. And we're continuing work through the National Trauma Training Programme to ensure our workforce is trauma-informed, recognises the impact of adverse experiences on children, and provides the right support to ensure no further harm is done. Whilst today's debate is an important opportunity to reflect on our collective work to keep the promise, in closing this debate, let me return to the celebration at the heart of this motion and extend my congratulations once again to St Andrew's Children's Society on their centenary. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.